Why foreclosure rate in Plainfield? And what will you do about the high number of abandoned homes as well? And Ms. River, you get to answer that first.
First part, what will you do to...
To reduce the high foreclosure rate. And the second part is, what will you do about the high number of abandoned homes?
One of the things that I would like to add to the second part was about the high number of abandoned homes. I would add the management of the department of, the management to go out to these abandoned homes and find out if there is on the city's tax base and have a lottery so that residents can take those abandoned homes, fix them up, and put them back on the tax base. That's one of the things that I would do.
What would I do about the reduce high foreclosure rates? I would get with a lot of, see, I don't have a degree in real estate. So what I would do is I would pull in a lot of real estate offices and see what we can do to help residents who are in foreclosures, get with banks, have different types of community events to see what we can do to stop these foreclosures, because we have a lot of foreclosures because of taxes. These homes are paid off, paid in full, but because the taxes in the city of Plainfield are so high, they're losing their homes to the city tax base. So we as a city, we would have to work with these residents to try to find a way to come up with a plan to help them save their homes.
Thank you. Mr. Mack.
The problem with foreclosures is a national problem. It's one that has been brought upon us by financial institutions. And the solution lies in several legislation that will prevent the predatory practices of financial institutions that exploit so many people and force them out of their homes. And so that is an issue that must be addressed at the state and federal level. In terms of the abandoned homes, many of these homes that are abandoned were foreclosed on by banks. And we are aggressively pursuing different avenues to force the banks to take care of these properties, because it's a cost to the city because of the services that we have to provide. And so we are currently looking at legislation. We're also talking to state representatives to give us more of a hammer so that we can address the problem of abandoned properties across the city. So we are aggressively working on tackling these abandoned properties, holding the banks accountable who are at the root of the problem.
Thank you. Dr. Davis Ibezie.
Well, the answers in the future, what they will do. The answers should be in the past of what they should have done. City Hall should have been talking to these banks well before now, requesting a meeting with the banks and looking at solutions to these problems. You do not need a rocket scientist to tell you this. If you do not talk to the banks, and if it takes warning the banks, you will not be able to make a difference in the lives of the citizens of this city. You must be able to reach out to the banks and say, listen, we have this problem. Come in and talk to us. We should be able to do that. You do not need a rocket scientist to do it. So let us not talk of the past. Let us do it now. And it would take replacing all those who have been in office before and bringing in a new blood like myself. Thank you.
Let me just say this very quickly. Mayor Mack has mentioned my name three times, and three times he has given wrong information. No one serving on the Board of Education is managing my campaign. I think he's talking about some board members who want to manage his campaign without getting involved in politics. But anyway, to answer the question, to reduce the high foreclosure rate, there are programs that are available to help people who are in foreclosure. I work with Reverend Dr. Wesley Soares at the First Baptist Church of Woody Garden, and he has implemented programs throughout the state that have helped people with foreclosures. So I would definitely introduce our city to some of those programs. And the abandoned homes, we have a request that the banks, you know, keep up the property when houses are abandoned, and we have to really hold them, you know, to the fire and let them know that we're not intolerant of abandoned buildings in our house, in our neighborhood, that they own.
Thank you. last question for the evening before the closing remarks. Plainfield has continually missed getting to the 50,000 people count in the census, which would allow it to be a city receiving support directly from the state and federal government. What will you do to ensure that Plainfield is fully counted in the 2020 census? And Dr. Davis Ibizbin, you go first.
The name is E-B-Z.
A-Z.
Just remember E-B and then Z. As your new mayor for next year, you will know how to pronounce the name very well. Now to the question, the meeting stands.
At 50,000 people in the census, you would be eligible for receiving support directly from state and federal government. And what are you going to do to ensure that Plainfield gets their full count in 2020?
Again, when census has been taken, we know. Again, when census has been taken, you do not need a rocket scientist to count the people in Plainfield. We are well close to 60,000 people in Plainfield. People have a special interest in putting that number below 50,000. And since you know that, you have to count the people yourself and make sure you know the numbers. If the city needs to do its own census, the city must get into the business of conducting the census in the city. So that's what we will do. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Matt.
Well, I have good news for you. Our population is over 50,000. When I took office, we had the opportunity to go it alone. We did the analysis, and it did not make sense for us to go it alone. So we entered into an agreement with Union County. Had we opted to do it ourselves, we would have lost roughly $750,000. That is the amount by which we would have been short. We would have received that amount less than what we are currently receiving. And so you just can't make statements without doing the analysis. We did the homework, and it did not make sense for Plainfield to go it alone. We could have in 2014 when I took office, but we will revisit that whole conversation when the census rolls around and when the agreement is up again. You can't make decisions without doing the analysis to see which way would be most advantageous to you and to your residents, and that's what we did.
Okay. Ms. Rivers.
I don't agree with you with anything else. I have to agree with that, because sitting on the council, again, we would have lost $750,000. That's why we had to utilize the county to help us round up residents to do the census. But again, we have to invest in our community, and we have to use our own people. We have to find a way to keep that $750,000, because it's convenient for us to be under $50,000, because under 50,000 people, we have to get money from the county. But if we can prove that we're over 50,000 people, our monies come straight from the federal government. So it's extremely important that we do another census when it comes back around. We have to find a way. We have to find a way now. We can't wait until the census is about to come around and say, we're going to do it this way. But we have to, again, use the people of Plainfield, the citizens of Plainfield, to get out here and get the right number of the people of Plainfield, so that if we lose 50,000, we'll gain more from the federal government once they prove that we have over 50,000 residents, which we do. But right now, our funds are limited, because we get it from the state instead of the federal government. Thank you.
Thank you. Reverend Brown.
I agree with Ms. Rivers in reference to making sure that the census is done accurately. We've got to understand that when there is over 50,000, that our city will receive money. So I think the only thing that can really be done is to make sure that it's just done accurately.
Thank you. That brings us to the third portion of this part of the program, and that is the closing statements. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to make a closing statement, and they will be going in the reverse order of the opening statements. So, Reverend Brown, you get to make your closing statement.
Yes, I don't pretend to know how to fix everything that's wrong with the city. I don't think one person has all the answers, but this I do know, that if the
office to unite the city. Our city is very, very divided. I surround myself with competent staff in every position, people who are experts in the field and not just out to get a paycheck at the expense of paying for residents. And there are some already in a position that are very competent and that are doing a great job. I work very hard for a proper medical facility, not just something to appease people, but something that our citizens will benefit from. I work hard for a youth center. I will not ignore the listen and adhere to the needs and the concerns of our senior citizens, or some of what we call seasoned saints. And I honor my boundaries and I overstep them in collaboration with the Board of Education. And I work hard to bring about a bipartisan attitude to our city. If it takes an entire village, then everybody ought to be included. Everybody's a stakeholder. In the words of the late great Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in his book entitled Strive for Freedom, in reference to people saying that pastors should not be in politics, Dr. King states that pastors must play a critical role in politics. And when we look at our city, one of the greatest mayors we ever had was also a pastor, and that is the late Reverend Dr. Evan C. Lamadore. And I know that if elected mayor, I'll work hard. I know that I'm going to be, these last 2 weeks, I'm going to be attacked, you know, by a lot of sources. But I think this community knows who I am, knows the work that I've done in this community, and knows that I walk in integrity, regardless of what this current administration may say. So vote G15, Reverend Tracy Brown, and change you trust.
Thank you. Mr. Mack.
I stand on my record of accomplishments. We have brought economic development into our city. We have driven down crime by over 25%. We've provided jobs to our young people, so much so that unemployment has declined from roughly 14% down to a low of 5.4%. We've invested in the recreational spaces for our young people. We're building a skate park. We're transforming Cyber Field. We're rebuilding our road. Over 17.5 miles of road have been resurfaced, more than has been done by anyone in recent memory or in the history of this great city of Plainfield. And we will make sure that we deliver. And I'm so glad that some of, you know, the council members, former council members, then current council members, have endorsed some of the programs that I've implemented. There will be a multi-purpose educational, entrepreneurial, and recreational center constructed at Hannah Atkins Park, where there will be indoor soccer, indoor football, basketball, and a track. And the upper level will have classrooms for our young people so that they can prepare themselves. And so these are the things that we have done, the things that we're doing. And, you know, one of my opponents said, let's take our city back. We're not going back. We must keep Plainfield moving forward. We have come a long way. We cannot turn back. We must build on what has been started. And there is no one sitting here who has articulated a vision for this city. Many of them have said what they would like to do and have not said how it can be done. I have walked the walk, and I ask each and every one of you, column A, all the way. Thank you.
She just asked me to get all of them, so I'm going to do that. When you elect people, you elect them to serve. They become your chief servant. When you elect them, you do not elect them to become your master or masters. Please, we have seen the Imperial Mayor of Plainfield. I want us to end that now. On June 6th, and you go to vote, you look at the column, it says line A. Please forget about line A and move straight to G and look for G16, G18 for camera cops, and G19 for AUS Simmons. You know these people, they've been amongst you all these years. They're not new. What they've decided to do is look for someone who can lead the city into our new future together. Please do not be deceived by people who've said all these years and not been able to do the things they promised. All of a sudden they're getting up. It's a new day. No. A city is as good as the persons they put into office. If you make that mistake and return the wrong persons into office, hold yourself responsible. You cannot be making these mistakes for life. Otherwise, you have yourselves to blame. Do not do it. I am the only person who has a sense of where we have to go to. I am the only person with that connection to bring you to Greenfield. And you have to realize. Do not make that mistake. I am new, yes. My name is somehow different, yes. But I have people around me to bring that future you have been looking for. Thank you.
Thank you. I
would again like to thank Shiloh Baptist Church for hosting this forum. I would like to thank the residents for coming out to hear so we can answer your questions. Again, as I stated at the NAACP forum, I could have ran with Mayor Mack. I could have ran with my other opponent. But when I looked around at where the city is and who have been controlling this city for this long, I said to myself, I could not sleep at night allowing the same old thing to continue to happen. And that's why I chose. I went into deep thought and I chose to run for mayor. The road plan that my opponent is talking about is a plan that was done under the previous administration. We're just implementing the roads now. Right now is time. This is like a presidential election in this great city of Plainfield. You must come out. I'm setting the standards, because if you don't come out and vote, you're going to have the same thing that happened with Donald Trump, and that's why he's here. Plainfield, I think, is extremely important that we come out, we support a great candidate, we support Bridget Rivers for mayor, Alma Blockwell for second and third ward, and all the committee members that are running with us. I have a plan to change Plainfield and move Plainfield forward. Right now, it's not one Plainfield, one future. It's some Plainfield, one future. And I plan to be the mayor for all of the wards in this great city of Plainfield. I plan to bridge it together. I plan to bring in a competent cabinet and not control the cabinet. I plan to do shared services with the school board, with the housing authority, with the PMUA, so that we can utilize our resources that we have here. It's important, Plainfield. We don't need a dictator. We need someone at the top that will allow the residents of Plainfield to become one. Again, I ask you, on June 6th, elect Bridget Rivers for mayor and Alan Blanco for city council, second and third ward. Show up and show up, Plainfield. Thank you.
Let us to give a round of applause to all the candidates who showed up. We'll be taking a 5-minute break. We're going to be changing the focus. It'll be the council candidates who will be up at the tables. If they can please come up to the table now and get their... This is recorded and will be on the website.